This video is sponsored by Disruptor. In a recent podcast interview, Donald Trump dusted off an oldie from all the way back on the campaign trail, criticizing decommissioned wind turbines as the bane of the environment. Specifically, he called out how turbine blades end up piled high in landfills. But here's the thing, he's not entirely wrong on this one. Now, there are plenty of things old 45 got wrong about wind turbines. No, they can't cause cancer. But while critics love to exploit every little flaw that crops up when it comes to renewables, sometimes green energy proponents can see the emerging technology with rose-colored glasses. So what exactly happens when windmills die? How does that impact the environment? And what's currently being done to address the issue? So first things first, let's try to win some of your favor back by hyping up all the things we love about wind energy. According to the EIA in 2020, wind turbines produced roughly 338 billion kilowatt hours in the U.S. alone, about 8.4% of total U.S. utility-scale electricity generation. Wind even produced more than 6% of electricity worldwide, with 743 gigawatt hours of global capacity. That's enough to power more than 500 million homes. Wind energy helps eliminate nearly 320 million metric tons of CO2 emissions annually. That's the carbon equivalent of six New York cities. One reason wind energy has seen such prolific growth in the last few decades is that it has grown to be one of the cheapest means of producing electricity in the world. According to the U.S. Department of Energy, wind energy prices have a levelized average cost below 2 cents per kilowatt hour, making it highly competitive against other baseload energy sources like natural gas and coal. Wind energy is completely carbon-free during its entire lifetime, producing zero greenhouse gas emissions while requiring little maintenance during that period. And what's best of all is that of the 8,000 plus total parts involved in building wind turbines, between 85 and 90% of all of it can be recycled. Things like steel, copper wire, electronics, and gearing. So if wind energy is so great, why does it catch so much hate? You could say wind turbines are like zombies. They don't really become a problem until they reach the end of their lives. And while nearly all components of these massive turbines can either be recycled or repurposed, the same can't be said for arguably the most critical component, and that is those massive turbine blades. It turns out those massive beasts are incredibly difficult to recycle. Why? For one thing, today's turbines are incredibly large, with land-based models reaching 525 feet tall, with turbines extending up to 170 feet, longer than a Boeing 747's wings. Offshore models can get up to 850 feet tall, with blades up to 350 feet long. That's about the length of 21 Tesla Model X's lined up bumper to bumper. Bigger, taller towers and longer blades are the key to optimizing maximum electricity generation. Unfortunately, those same large blades also require huge amounts of cost in terms of transportation, requiring multiple diesel-burning trucks, tractors, and trains. But the issue isn't so much the size, it's the materials they're made out of. Wind turbines need to be incredibly lightweight so as to increase their aerodynamic efficiency, but also need to be incredibly strong, sturdy enough to withstand hurricane force winds. The go-to material for today's turbine blades is a combination of glass, carbon fiber, epoxy resin, and balsa wood. By undergoing a process of heating and mixing, the materials bind together, becoming incredibly strong while remaining light, generally having lifespans of up to 25 years. However, it's those precise materials that make these blades incredibly difficult to recycle once they're done. Sawing through the tough blades requires diamond-encrusted industrial saws, and while it is possible to cut the blades into segments on-site during decommissioning, they are still challenging to transport. Then there's the issue of the composite materials themselves. Separating the glass fibers from the plastic and resin to recycle into a workable material is incredibly challenging. This is why so many decommissioned wind turbines end up in landfills. And the problem? Well, it's not going away anytime soon. Many first and second generation wind turbines are reaching the end of their tenure. And with the 2021 U.S. infrastructure bill allocating $100 million to expand wind generation, we could be seeing more and more blades end up in landfills. We talk a lot about promising and upstart companies, and if you're at all interested in investing, you'll love our sponsor this week. Disruptor is a mobile application for investments in private companies at the pre-IPO and mid-stage. It's similar to investing in the stock market, but instead of public stock, you invest in the development of private space tech, fintech, biotech, food tech, and other cutting-edge businesses that plan to go public, companies like SpaceX. There are some requirements, so head over to the link in the description to see if you qualify and get started with as little as $10,000. Disruptor also has a YouTube channel with awesome videos on disruptive technology in action. Videos like this on space exploration and the colonization of Mars, or this one on the future of drone deliveries. Really good stuff. Trust me, you gotta go check it out. Now, I'm not a financial expert and investing comes with risk, but if you're interested in investing with Disruptor or wanna check out their YouTube channel, we'll have links in the video description. Huge thanks to Disruptor and you for supporting the companies that support this show. Current statistics estimate the turbine blades are set to account for roughly 43 million metric tons of waste by 2050, making up an eighth of all discarded plastic annually. Images of dirty turbine blades piled up in landfills like whale carcasses are often used as fodder for those opposed to renewables, which begs the question, how green can a product be if it's just going to end up in a landfill? So does that mean recycling them is impossible? Not exactly. In fact, a number of companies are aiming to find ways to do just that. In Germany, for example, a joint venture between two companies, Geocycle and Zahones, has innovated a way to recycle these composite materials through cement co-processing. This is sort of a two-stage process. First, the organic content in the blade is recovered as thermal energy, basically fuel used in the cement-making process. Then the inorganic materials like the glass fibers and fillers are used to partially replace raw materials in the cement itself. The process promises 100% recycling. But wait, burning the blades? Surely that can't be beneficial for the environment, can it? It turns out, cement making has a huge carbon footprint, producing roughly 8% of all greenhouse gas emissions worldwide, and that's nearly four times more than the entire aviation industry. Replacing traditional fossil fuels like coal with organic materials found in these turbines could reduce CO2 emissions by up to 16%, which isn't a ton, but it's better than nothing. Outside of concrete, other companies are working on ways to incorporate more of these materials. Global Fiberglass Solutions in Sweetwater, Texas, is developing a method to break down the blades and press them into pellets and fiberboards, which can be used in a number of applications, including flooring and walls. According to the company, up to 99.9% of the blades can be processed for up to 7,000 blades a year. There's also the question of whether we can start making these turbine blades out of more recyclable materials in the first place. A number of companies, including Spain-based energy company Siemens Gamesa, who have experimented with new types of resins that can be more efficiently separated from other components of the blade, making what they claim to be the world's first fully recyclable turbine blades. Other companies like German-based WPD have teamed up with a company in San Diego, California to begin installing more recyclable blades on their offshore turbines. What it really boils down to, though, like always, is cost. As great as all these initiatives are, it's still cheaper for companies to just dump their blades in a landfill, at least for now. For wind to grow as prevalent as it has in the last couple of decades, took a combination of public support and market incentives. It will likely take those same forces to develop a better infrastructure for a more circular, renewable economy moving forward. A lack of both industry incentives and regulatory demand makes it all the easier for companies to simply abandon their retired turbines. But is that such a terrible thing? I mean, yes, obviously the goal should be to reduce as much landfill waste as possible. With recyclability between 85-90%, that's significantly better than the waste footprint of many other industries. And with the significant reduction in carbon emissions that wind energy brings, I think it's time we stop looking at wind energy with those green tinted glasses. Worst case scenario, even if wind turbines do end up in landfills, when it comes to net pollution, they are leaps and bounds better than coal or any other fossil fuel. Wind turbines, once built, can operate for decades producing free, clean energy. The same just can't be said about any fossil fuel, which you burn in an instant. Then there's the idea of exponential advancement with technology. As we mentioned earlier in the video, modern wind turbines didn't really come into their own until the 1970s. Since then, not only have prices gone down, but the technology has significantly improved over the years. What adversaries of green energy see as deficits, engineers see as opportunity. We need to break out of this black and white, all or nothing thinking. Just because some green technology isn't perfect from cradle to grave doesn't mean it should just be abandoned altogether. It's not a scam. And yes, there are some major failures along the way. On the flip side, we don't have to be blind to the shortcomings that technology might have in order to get behind it. We have to remember what's on the table is the future of our planet. But what do you think? Do the benefits of wind energy outweigh the deficits? What do you think about recycling or reusing materials in the blades? Sound off in the comments below. But before you go, we have just enough time for the comment of the week. All right, our first comment comes from Michael Kudel, who says, yeah, people running around with small nukes. What could possibly go wrong? And that is in regard to our small nuclear reactors video. The thumbnail is of a car. It's kind of a clickbaity thing. The video is not about nuclear-powered cars, but yes, thank you for your comment. The second one comes from Jan Rasmussen, who says, use a tree. This is in regard to our carbon capture video. Yes, I agree with you. Trees are amazing. We should definitely be doing that as well. All right, check out some of our other videos we think you're going to like, and we'll see you next week.